was 11, 29. And it says here that for the gifts and the calling of God are without repentance. This is actually King James Version, because I was going to get into that part too. In the New King James, it says, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. But if you go back and look at the at repentance, when you look at repentance, I'm going to stay on this for just a second because there's a lot of stuff to get into. But repentance, when you have a calling of God on your life and you finally figure out what it is, not only does God not take it away from you, but you are not to apologize for the gift that He's placed in you. At all. If God calls you to pray, you pray for people. If God tells you to prophesy over people, you prophesy over people. It doesn't matter what you say, how you pray, what you say to people, it's through God. It's not through you. So there's no repentance of anything if the call of God was on your life. Even apostolic, like Pastor Doug, you know. Later on in Oasis, he's going to be planting churches. You know, he's going to be an apostolic father to many. And he's not going to apologize to anybody for the direction that he gives them, because it's all God-led. We're a God-fearing church. So we're not going to apologize to anybody unless we mess it up and we have to go to God and ask for apology. So the calling of God on your life is irrevocable. It's without repentance. You've got to examine yourself and understand the call of God on your life. Now when you go down to Romans 12, and you look at verse 3 through 8, it says, for I say through the grace given to me, to everyone who is among you, not to think of himself, that's us, that's me, that's you, more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly as God has dealt to each one a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, but all the members do not have the same function, so we being many are one body in Christ and individually members of one another. Having then gifts differing according to the grace that is given to us, let us use them. If prophecy, let us prophesy in proportion to our faith. Or ministry, let us use it in our ministering. He who teaches, in teaching. He who exhorts, in exhortation. He who gives, with liberality. He who leads, with diligence. He who shows mercy, with cheerfulness. So we go back to the beginning of this. It says to think soberly. You know, the calling of God I have on my life, it's easy, it's really easy to take it, how would I say? You think God talks to you more than everybody else with a prophetic mantle that you carry, but it's not. When you start to mature, you understand that God wants to talk to everybody. So when you start to think out, you know, a calling that God has on my life with my prophetic gift is to teach other people how to hear. So if I just walk around and I don't teach everybody else how to hear God and how to hear His voice like I do prophetically, that's arrogant of me, because I'm not giving anybody else the opportunity to experience God in the full measure that you guys should be able to experience. An apostolic gift, you can get crazy with an apostolic gift. I don't have this in my notes, I'm just talking about it, but you know, there's some people that will put an apostle title in front of their name or prophet in front of their name, but yet it's really not for, it's more of a glamour. It's more of, look at me, I've studied, I've showed myself, but it's not really, I'm boasting in God, I'm boasting in myself. It's arrogance. You can't do this all by yourself. It says that we are all, there's many members of one body. We'll do the same thing with the left hand that came with the right. You know, it's kind of hard to drive a stick shift if you have one leg. You know, you have to have two legs. There's a function behind that. Praise God for automatics, I don't worry.
Amen.
There's functions in the body. Just because you may be a person of prayer, just because you may be a prophet of God or an apostle of God, just because you might be a teacher or a pastor, there's nothing that should put you above anybody else. Because we're not here to label, we're here to build up people in the kingdom of God. So the arrogance has to be kicked to the side, because everyone has their own unique gift. You know, no one person can move fully in all the gifts of the Spirit. I don't care who you are. You can't move fully in all the gifts, and it tells us that in Scripture. It actually says it here, but I think I have, I thought it was somewhere else too. But it says, having then gifts differing. If you look in 6-8, gifts differing. That means God doesn't say, here, I'm going to give you all the 9 gifts of the Spirit. You can flow in them 100%. It doesn't work like that. Does not work like that. You got to know your personality, that God's created you for the purpose and the plan that He has on your life. So let's get rid of the arrogance. Nobody is higher than anybody. We all have to be accepting. Everybody has a purpose in the house of God. Amen.
Amen.
Now we go over here to when you get your calling down, or even when you live a Christian life. And you preach the Christian life, just like I'm pretty sure it's in Romans, Pastor, correct me if I'm wrong, but the Great Commission says that Jesus told his disciples to go out amongst the nations and preach my word. You know, nobody in the church, in the kingdom of God, is a bench warmer. We're not pew sitters. That's not what we're called to do. Everybody has a purpose. Regardless of what level and intensity you want to go with that, you know, I hear pastor all the time, you know, somebody needs prayer, he wants to go to the Lord. Well, that's an honor, you know. The Lord's happy to be able to pray for people. She takes pride in that. You know, God placed a gift in me that I like to pray and I have a heart for people. She likes to reach out. Doesn't matter. But your walk, over here in Matthew 7, in verse 13 to 14, it talks about the narrow gate and the wide path to destruction. It says, enter by the narrow gate, for wide is the gate and broad is the way that leads to destruction, and there are many who go in by it. Because narrow is the gate and difficult is the way which leads to life, and there are few who find it. See, it's difficult to walk in the calling that you have on your life. And you know, sometimes it's difficult for me, depending on who I hang out with, because you know, if you hang out with a certain group too long, you kind of take on their character. But also, depending on who you put yourself around, you know, you're going to face criticism, you're going to face rejection, and you're going to feel like an outcast. You know, especially where I work, the 2 jobs I have, you know, I face criticism all the time. They're like, you know, you believe in God, but, you know, all this stuff happens. You know, they're criticizing my faith. And they're rejecting the fact that God's real, which I believe. So in turn, if they're rejecting God, they're rejecting me. And you know, that makes some people feel like an outcast. And I call those people faith destroyers. I'm not saying that they can't be helped, but you know, the devil can put anybody in your path, whether good or bad, a pastor, a mom, dad, anybody. Anybody can say little things to get you off path. If you're trying to pray, or you're trying to sit down and study the Word of God, and somebody keeps calling you on the phone and want to talk to you for a half hour, you know, maybe they want to talk about something, maybe they just want to ramble, but, you know, the devil knows when the work of God is getting ready to happen to somebody's life, and he'll try to disrupt it in any way, even if it's a 45-minute conversation, to get your mind off of him. I call that faith destroyers. Because when you go over to Hebrews 11:6, you know, it says, without faith it is impossible to please him. It says, but without faith it is impossible to please him. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. See, I think we look more at he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. You know, we try to go after and learn what God has, but yet when it comes down to the nitty-gritty and something needs to happen, we don't have the faith. But we look at the second part of that scripture and we're like, you know, God said he's going to reward us because we're looking out for him. No, you got to have faith and know that what you're looking after is what God told you to look after. How can you walk in your own calling and believe in who you are without faith? I know some of you may not know what your calling is. Well, this is the best place for you to be if you feel like you're connected with Pastor Doug, because part of his ministry is bringing out the gifts in people. Part of this church is bringing out the gifts in people, raising people up to be better men and women of God. So you got to practice your faith diligently, because diligently seeking Him isn't just studying His Word, isn't just praying to Him. You got to have faith in situations. You know, we're going through our faith class, and you know, Dr. Pulis talks about you can't wait until the time that you have cancer and then go into the cancer room and the doc gives it to you, and he's like, you're going to die in 6 weeks and then have faith if you haven't had faith for healing from a headache. You're going to take ibuprofen. There's a lot of power behind that. There's a lot of power behind that. If you can't have a headache and just lay your hand on yourself and say, God, headache be gone, because you said I shouldn't have any headaches. You can't hurt. Why am I hurting? If you can't believe for that, how are you going to believe for a medical atrocity that comes into your life? You know, what's greater than being rewarded by God according to His call in your life? What's greater than God telling you what your calling is and you actually moving in it? You see, we have on earth and our worldly possessions and in the natural. You know, when I was in retail, the biggest thing I wanted to be was a manager. Because I figured when I got to that point, in my heart, I wanted to help people. I want to look at people and fix situations. Now, depending on what type of management you're in, you can do that. You can have one-on-one time, but in retail, you can't really do that. So I was looking for that worldly acceptance. And then I finally got it. It only lasted for a couple years, and I gave it up because the calling that God has on my life is greater than anything of this world that I could ever ask for or receive. You know, we take the honors of this world, but yet when a prophet comes to you or a pastor is mentoring you, or somebody, or God's just put somebody in your life to tell you, hey, this is the life that you have. We don't honor that. We don't take that to heart. You know, so if your work manager at work or something, or your boss comes and says, hey, I'm going to give you a promotion. Yes, I got a promotion, but, you know, pastor's counseling, you know what, I believe God told you to, you know, you need to preach. I don't want to preach. I don't think I'm called to do that. I don't want to prophesy. I don't want to pray after him and give people words. You know, we went to an evangelism seminar at Dr. Pulis' church a month or so ago, and this guy quoted out of his in his curriculum, a guy named David Livingstone, and he said, if a commission by an earthly king is considered an honor, then how can a commission by a heavenly king be considered a sacrifice? See, we struggle, and I have too, and I even did last time I preached, I struggled with the fact that I had to get in front of you guys and give you a word. And that was, I took that to heart afterwards. But you know, when a manager or somebody comes to me at work and they're like, they put me on this pedestal, I need you to do this, that's awesome, because everybody else looks up to me. But you consider things of a church a sacrifice because you think it's just, all right, I got to go to church on Sunday. This is what religious people do. It's Christianity. Well, Christianity isn't religion. Going to religion every Sunday or every Wednesday ain't just going to cut it for you. Because God also talks to us in Scripture about how to guard your calling. This is what he told me out of the Scripture, guarding your calling. In Matthew chapter 7, verse 21 to 23. It says, not everyone who says to me, Lord, Lord, shall enter the kingdom of heaven, but he who does the will of my Father in heaven. Many will say to me in that day, Lord, Lord, have we not prophesied in your name, cast out demons in your name, and done many wonders in your name? And then I will declare to them, I never knew you, depart from me, you who practice lawlessness. You know, all is. Just because I'm sitting up here preaching to you guys today, and I'm working towards what I'm supposed to do in the calling of my life, doesn't mean I already made it to heaven. I can backslide tomorrow. You know, I could be giving Him glory today, and tomorrow I could be crucifying Him again in just a little sin. You know, like Pastor says, you know, Him eating certain things, that's a sin. Well, that's crucifying God, in my opinion. I mean, we gotta really take this to heart. This is heavy stuff. Because the call of God on your life has to become you. This is what God created you to be. Because if anything that you've done on earth, if it isn't for the glory of God, then what are you doing it for? What are you doing it for? For yourself? Well, if you're doing it for yourself, then what are you gonna get out of it? If you're gonna tell people about God so you can look better, then what are you gonna benefit? You're not gonna benefit anything because God isn't behind it. You know, you also gotta be careful who you connect with. You know, it says in Matthew 7:15-20, you gotta judge their fruits. You gotta judge, and it talks about prophets in there too, but I think it talks about people in general. You know, it took me, how many churches did we go to through Rick? Five before we came here. We would have been here sooner, but we couldn't figure out where the church was or what the name of the church was here. But you know, it says to judge the fruits. Not saying that every church you go to, if you don't feel connected, that they're really bad people. But you got to get your calling and the purpose that God has on your life, and you got to get it connected somewhere. So, if with Pastor and his apostolic gift, you know, Scripture tells us that the apostle is the head of a church, and the prophet is right there with it, but they're the foundations. You can't have a full foundation of a church without both. It's Scripture. And you can't have teachers, you can't have pastors, you can't have prayer warriors, you know, just like I was saying, everything that's involved in the church. But as far as my calling itself, I can run rampant. You know, God talks to me all the time, and you know, there's some things that I know that I can't say. You know, that's the calling He has on my life, and I gotta learn. And pastors put me in line quite a few times because there's times I just wanted to jump out and tell somebody, you know, slap them in the face. Why don't you know this? You should know this is what God's saying. But you know, I gotta tame myself because prophets can get a little wild. So you got to be careful who you connect with. You got to judge their fruits. Are they the best fit for me? God, is this where you want me to go? Always got to involve God in everything. Because not everybody in this people is for the kingdom of God. You know, you see on TV LA preachers, and you know, there's stuff even happening around here locally with churches. You know, they're expanding and tearing down certain parts of things and building all new, but they really haven't expanded the people that are in their church or the calling that they have on their life. They're just going in somewhere and just saying, I want to be bigger because it's going to look better. So we're going to tear this down and build this up. But then they shut down. And then they have church splits. And then everybody quits coming to the church. And then they lose their finances. And then they can't pay for what they just did because it wasn't God-driven. You know, it's sad to say that, but there's pastors that really don't care about the advancement of the kingdom of God as long as they look good. If they look good doing it, then by all means, let's do it. You got to make sure you judge their fruits. It says that in Matthew 7:16. It's the exact verse that it says it. And it says, know those that labor among you. And you got to know the... When you get into a place and you know your calling, figure out what everybody else's calling is. You know, I believe that I have the same level of gift that I haven't built up yet, but I believe that I can help people figure out what their calling is. It's something that we have to build up, but you got to know those that labor among you. You can't have two apostolic heads of one church. This ain't gonna work because God's vision in each one of those people And we, either a pastor too, God has a calling on each one of them. They can't both be the head of one church. You can't have two heads. There's only one. You have God, which is, you can't even include, I wouldn't include him in the church as far as being the head, but he is. He's the guy that, this is all flowing through him. So you have, as far as human and in a natural sense, we have one head. Spiritually, there's only one person to go to, and that is God. So we got to make sure that every decision we make is a godly choice. You know, pastors talked about this, and before we started this faith class, he went through the visions and stuff, and he talked about how the first part of his life was, it was all an accident. He said, God just blessed me. Everything that happened, I never involved him on everything. He said, and what's happened to me, and I'm blessed, he said that, I'm considered that a favor, but he said, from here on out, he said, I'm not going to make a decision unless God's involved. That's powerful stuff, people. I mean, that gets, if God tells you to do something, you do it. Those are the ones that are get rewarded because they diligently seek him, because they have the faith to know that God told them to do that, so they're going to go out and do it, and they're going to accomplish what God has on their life. Now, as I told you earlier, the call of God in your life is irrevocable. So over here, and let's go to 2 Timothy. Chapter 1, verses 8 through 9. It says, therefore do not be ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but share with me in the sufferings for the gospel according to the power of God, who has saved us and called us with a holy calling, not according to our works, not according to what we do, but according to his purpose and grace, which was given to us in Christ before time began. According to his grace, because if we do stuff from our works, we need the grace of God to get back into our purpose of life that he has on us. So don't be ashamed of what God's called you to do. You know, you got to endure the battle, and you got to endure the walk. The same things that we desire, when it says here Christ before time began. You know, when God was talking to me when I was reading the scripture, he talked to me about before I was born. You know, he had a purpose over my life. I didn't have works, you know. In my Uncle John's church, when I was still in my mom's womb, my Uncle John prophesied over me that I was going to be a prophet. I was going to be a, God was going to flow through me, and power of God hit. You know, there's a big deal when God's involved in anything in anybody's life. There's a big deal. And, you know, God bless my grandma that was raised up Catholic because she's Italian. Got scared to death because she never experienced anything like that. Bless her. She got up and left. She thought I was going to die. But, you know, he said that the devil had a mark on my life, and he was wanting to take me out. Because what God's called me to do, he doesn't want to see happen. And when I was born, I can't go off my own works. I can't just do stuff and say this is going to happen and be able to defeat Satan at the same time. You know, everything that we desire, God created us in his image. We were created from him. So the desire that he has is the same desire that we have in our own hearts. What we desire and what we love and what we love to do, he loves us to do, and he loves for us to do it. You know, I love prophecy. I love moving in the prophetic. I love being around people that are like it. God loves that too. You know, like I said, Laura likes to pray. I'm sure Laura would love to be in a room full of people that love to pray. Well, God would love that too. You know, if you're a pastor, you know, Dr. Paulus has roundtable meetings, and he has all the pastors. So what greater honor is it, you know, for God to construct something for people of all the same likeness to get together, that have the same gifts in the call in their life, but to a different place, to be able to just come together and share ideas and relate to one another. You know, that's an honor in itself. Because Scripture, talking about from when before I was born, you know, Scripture doesn't talk to us about having a destiny. Now, I looked up that word destiny, and I've not seen it in the Scriptures. Now, if it is in there, I would really like somebody to correct me, but when I started to look, I didn't find it anywhere. The only thing I found was plan and purpose. No destiny for your life. And why? Because that's going to take away your own free will. You know, if you have a destiny on your life, then regardless of what you do and everything I've told you up until this point on your calling of God, doesn't matter. Because it's just going to happen. That's destiny. Destiny's just going to happen regardless. You can't make it happen. You know, you compare it to your life. You know, compare to planning out your life. You have a goal. What's your goal? What's your purpose? You plan it out. Well, what's planning? That's a strategy. And then you have to achieve the goal. So what happens when you achieve the goal? You fulfill the plan and the purpose that God has on your life. We don't have a goal, which is our destiny is our goal. That, I don't see that in there. That takes away what God wants us to do and diligently seek Him and have faith and look after Him and study His Word. You know, like it says in 2 Timothy 2:15, you know, study to show yourself approved. And other scriptures, it talks about according to your calling. Walk in the way that you're called to walk. But God has placed in everybody their own skill set according to the desires of your heart. Because they're the same desires of His heart. Because when you go out and you walk this road, you know, like I said back in Matthew 7, there's a narrow gate that we can walk. It's like walking between this guitar and this altar. I can walk through this and struggle to walk through it and not hit anymore. Or I can just walk around it like the rest of the world does and just get to where I want to get to. But you know what? That's not what God wants. Because when we go down this road, we're going to face criticism, humility. People are going to take shots at us. People are going to try and knock us down. Faith destroyers. But if we go around and walk around this wide gate, then you're just like the rest of everybody else. You're just going to go by the world, fly under the radar, and not be noticed. Then your plan of purpose in God isn't. Your calling smothered. That calling doesn't come into full force because you just avoided the walk that God had in your life, regardless of the battles. Everybody battles differently. But God has, I thank God for the battles He puts in my life because it makes me stronger. So I'm going to go down that narrow path and I'm going to fight whatever He puts in front of me because yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, He tells me He's going to be with me in every step I take. Let's go over here to Ephesians. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 1 through 6. This scripture here talks about unity in the church and amongst your peers. And the people that you come in contact with. It says, therefore, the prisoner of the Lord beseech you to walk worthy of the calling which you were called. This is where I was telling you, where he talks about, you know, walk in the way that you're called to walk. I just told you guys that. I forgot that I had the scripture here. I knew it was there, but my mind was somewhere. But walk worthy of the calling with which you were called, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another to love. Endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. Because there is one body and one Spirit, just as you were called in one hope of your own calling. One Lord,
one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, and in all of us. Now, I did some research on what some of these words mean, and this was the last scripture I pulled up in my study where God talked to me about unity. And it's funny because he kind of ties it in with some of the other stuff in Romans, but if we go back and look at the word beseech, you know, that means to invite, to call near. The prisoner of the Lord beseech you to walk worthy of the calling with which you were called. You gotta bring your calling close to you. You gotta harness it. You gotta pull that desire of that calling, because the calling that you have on your life isn't something that just God's called you to do. That's a desire that you have, and you gotta unlock it. You gotta find it. Invite it into your life. And worthy, walking worthy, walking appropriately. I can't hang out with the kids I used to hang out with when I was in high school. You know, I was going to church then, and I was still hanging out with them, and I thought I was doing good, but you know, when you get a little bit older, it's not bad to have yourself around those type of people, depending on the influence you got and depending on the level of faith that you have in your life and the strength that you have in your own calling. Because it can get wavered. Your faith can get tested. Just because those people are friends, because you've known them since you were in grade school, from kindergarten up, you know, they can waver your outcome in your relationship with God. It's a big deal. I have friends that I haven't hung out with, I can tell you, in over 7 years. But they have taken a totally different path than what I have. You know, some of them have converted to atheism. Some of them do nothing but work and don't care about anything else but making money. If I stayed around them, I could have gone down that path. I wouldn't say I'd be an atheist because I believe in God, but you know that they, I could have gone out there and made money, been a part of the world, the fame and the glamour, but yet I would still be empty. Because that calling that God placed in me when I was still in my mom's womb, when he had my uncle prophesy to me, would just be some dirt with a seed in it, no water. It's not going to grow. Going on down, you know, it says, with all lowliness and gentleness, with long suffering, bearing with one another in love. Lowliness means humbleness. To be lowly with somebody is to humble yourself when you're in their presence. You know, be humble about who you're called to be. Don't be arrogant like what I told you guys back in Romans 12, 3-8. And then long suffering, we gotta be patient with people. You know, God, the great commission that we're all called to, God said, go out and preach to the nations. Not everybody's going to accept you. Some people will. But just because one person doesn't accept you, believe me, there's been people I've talked to that do not believe or have believed but don't believe now. And, you know, they still have that little bit of hope, but they're like, you know, I haven't seen anything happen. You know, we got to be patient. Even with the people that are in Christ that know what their calling is. You know, some people think that they have a lower calling. I've heard people say, you know, if I'm not part of what we coin the fivefold ministry, then what's my purpose in the church? Everybody has a purpose. You know, it's not the ministers in the church, but it's the people of the church that have got to be patient with those people. They got to humble themselves with the knowledge that they have to share, and to endure. You know, it says in Romans 12, you know, don't be drunk to your calling. So we got to be humble, patient, and endure with one another through their own struggle to get them to the fullness of their purpose in God. And it says endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit and the bond of peace. You know, it says endeavoring to keep. That's not hoping. That's not praying it's going to happen. That's making an effort. That's being diligent, that's laboring in the church, laboring in the word, laboring with people, studying. That's endeavoring, not letting it fly by. And in the rest of the verse, it says there's one bond, there's one body and one spirit, just as you were called and one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all, through all, in you all. People, it doesn't matter whether you're called to the gift of helps, whether you have a prophetic gift, or you have an apostolic gift, whether you have a preaching gift, whether you're a prayer warrior. Everybody has a purpose. We are all to be in one unity with each other. Because there's only one God that we answer to. We don't answer to the pastor as far as what our calling is. He can help us figure it out, but only God gives us our calling. God tells us what we're supposed to do. This week alone, God's really has hit me hard. And the revelation that he gave me this week, I've really taken to heart, because I did a 3-day fast, Wednesday, Thursday, and Friday. And Pastor's probably been so apparently smart, but he's actually came to me before and told me to do a fast, and I ignored it. It's like I told you guys, you know, I backslide. I said I don't listen to my pastor sometimes, and he wants to hit me in the head, but we still got to be patient, like it tells us here when we walk in unity. So thank God for the pastor's patience.
Help a little hint there.
So what does God do this week before I have to preach? I don't want you to eat anything but drink water. Just consume water for 3 days before you preach. Now, people, I've been in church pretty much my whole life. And I've been around people that do Daniel fasts, and I've always refused to do them. This is the first fast I've ever done in my entire life. I'm 27 years old, and I've been in the church my entire life. Never fasted. I was scared to death. I didn't know if I'd make it. But the pastor told me, he was like, you know what? I told you to fast little things so you get ready for this, but you wouldn't listen, so God had to punch you right between the eyes. So Wednesday comes, and I'm a little grumpy, but you know, God carries me through it. My wife didn't want to be around me. But the big thing, and I know it was only 3 days, and it's not very long compared to what other people do, but Thursday was my biggest test. But it was also my biggest connection that I had with God. And I had to take a Spanish class from Bridgeport High School up to a dinner cruise, Spanish dinner cruise. And I was on that boat for 4 hours. And I wasn't allowed to eat anything. And I even told Brittany, I was so pumped when I told her I got the trip. I was like, I love Mexican food. I'm going to get up there. All this is going to be great. They're going to have a mariachi band there. Everything is just, it's going to be awesome. And then she was like, yeah, but you're not allowed to eat. This is going to be terrible. But, you know, God has a way of working things out. And it's funny. The lady that was the teacher of the class on the drive up there, by the time we got to Fairmont, started talking to me about God. She's a believer, and she has faith. She told me she was Catholic, but I'm not going to say her name. I don't know how she's Catholic with the beliefs that she had, because they're pretty much the same as mine. And I'm not going to get into the religious debate of what different beliefs have, but you know, God knew that she had faith, and she's endured things before. And I was in a struggle on the way up there, because I thought my stomach was going to rumble the whole time. And I thought I was just going to hunger and lust for the food that was on there. You know, I thought for sure that's what was going to happen. But for an hour and a half, when she started talking to me in Fairmont, on the drive up there, she sat behind me, and we talked about God pretty much the whole time. And it put me in the zone, and I started thinking to him. And we get up there, and we're still on the boat for an hour. And it still comes to my mind, you know, they're getting ready to bring out the food, and I'm going to look at it and want some, and I'm going to be hungry, and it's just going to be a terrible 3-hour ride. and boarding took about an hour. And about 6:30, right before they took off, I went up to the top deck. It was a triple-decker boat. I went up to the top. I was the only one up there. One other little boy was up there that wasn't down there yet. But little boy, they're high school students, but he was little with me. I sat at the front of the boat, and I started praying to God, and you know, I wasn't hearing him. So I was like, here we go. He's not going to be here with me. This is the test. So how am I going to make this through? But then I go back down there. And not only does the Spanish teacher that went up there with us, the lady that's a Spanish teacher at South Harrison went with us too, and she's a believer. So she starts talking about all these faith things that God did through her life. And you know, she's talking about the flood in New Orleans and Katrina and how she was all part of this. And you know, when she bought her house, she either could get wind insurance or flood, and God told her to get flood, even though it was cheaper. She was thinking, I want the cheaper one. And then God made a flood on her house, and she praised him for that. She's telling me all these stories. And the one thing God reminded me when I was sitting there is, I'm not going to tell you to step into a battle and not have your back. If you listen to what I tell you to do, I will be with you 100%. And he put those people there in front of me to keep my mind off of food. And it, not one time in that 4 hours I was on that boat did I hunger at all. I had 2 cups of coffee, and I had 1 big thing of water. And I did not hunger one time. Coffee. Even sitting there in front of, yeah. I couldn't drink much because it was hurting my stomach, so I quit. But I sat down there with them while they ate, had the food going in my face. Like I said, mariachi band was playing, everything was good, but I did not hunger. Because God told me to do this fast. And you do what God tells you to do, he's gonna do what he can to fulfill what he says, because he can't lie. And he can't do wrong. So later on, you know, I heard that one little piece of assurance from him, and I didn't hear anything else. So I go back up to the top of the boat. I'm sitting up here, and I feel like I need to share this with somebody watching on YouTube. Somebody in this church is probably going to get this, because it hit me pretty hard. But and I had a little notebook and a pad, and I was writing. I had like a whole page of stuff. I was just sitting there listening to him for 2 hours, just writing every time he told me stuff. And I stopped. I'm sitting in the chair, all these kids around me. And I couldn't even hear these kids. I was so in tune with hearing God's voice. I was watching the water flow and all these buildings fly by. I mean, we were going pretty fast on this boat. It was just a beautiful sight. And there was this cup sitting on the table in front of me. Not very far. Probably not that far away from me. And I was looking out at the riverbank and looking at all the buildings as we came by. And God told me, he said, that looks pretty focused in your eyes, doesn't it? I said, yeah, it does. He said, well, look in front of you. He said, can you focus on what's in front of you while you're focused on what's out there? That cup was a blur. I didn't even know that cup was there until I refocused my eyes in. Guys, look at me. Literally, and try to focus on the pew that's in front of you or the person that's in front of you. If you have your eyes focused on me, everything in front of you in this diameter right here is a blur. Can't see it. Can't do it. And God told me, he said, I go back to the words that were over my life and what people have said. I was even told by one person at Dr. Coles' church, you don't need a word, you already know what to do. And God reminded me of that too. And he said, if you bring back in and refocus on the steps that I have in front of your feet, what you see that you want and what your heart's desires are in the future, I will make come to pass. Because in Psalms 37, verse 23, it says, the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his ways. So people in the church, people on YouTube that are hearing this,
know what your calling is, but don't look beyond where you're at. Don't try to get ahead of yourself. You know, I've heard pastors say just last week that I'm a 27-year-old, but I want 40-year-old knowledge. That's just the heart that I have for God. I want to be at the next level every time I come into the church. I want to experience everything He has for me. I want to be done with what I'm supposed to do. But then I know if I'm done, when it's done, it's done. But just don't let what's in front of you become a blur, regardless whether it's a battle, regardless whether it's a door open and God trying to bless you. Focus on what's close. God has the rest because He can't fail. Dear God, I thank You for this word that You've given us today. And I pray Your blessing over God. And I hope You minister to the people in this church and those that are listening on YouTube like You did me, God. And our hearts are open and our minds and views are changed on the calling that we have on our life, God, and what we're supposed to do. And how we're to seek after You with faith that's unwavering. Thank You, God, for Your guidance and Your grace. Amen.